In this video, I would like to discuss the second end of chapter question from chapter 21 from the book Chemistry Cubed. And I will just read out the question. Suggest reagents for the following transformations. More than one step may be required for each transformation. And in parentheses, the relative stereochemistry of the product is shown, not the absolute stereochemistry. And we see 8 different reactions here. We also see them on screen. So we are starting here with an alkene component that's reacting somehow. So the analysis of the question first is, we know the substrate and we know the product, and we need to suggest reaction conditions, how we can transform our substrate into the different products here. And how I would access this question is always first analyze the groups or functional fragments that we have in our starting material and our product molecule, and then basically go from there and find, okay, how I can transform something into the desired groups here somehow. So let's first do this. The first reaction we are going to discuss here is this one. So the starting material is quite obvious. It's a cyclohexene with a methyl group and an alkene. So we are having an alkene. And then as our first reaction product, we are having a syndiol. So we are having 2 hydroxy groups added to that here. And they are on the same side of the molecule. So that's what the question means with like the relative stereochemistry. So let's write this down. It's a syndiol. Second product that we are seeing here is somehow an alcohol, and the oxygen is attached to the carbon atom with the methanol group attached. So this looks like something like an alcohol. Let's write this down. Then the next product that we are seeing, we are adding a bromine molecule and we are adding an hydroxy group to our double bond somehow. So this also again looks like an addition reaction, but in this case here, the newly added bromine atom and the hydroxy group are in antiposition to each other. So we can write down anti-bromo alcohol. So I think this is a quite good description of what is happening here. In this case, we are again having the a hydroxy group added to the molecule, but this time it's not in the position where the methyl group is attached in the second case, but rather it's on the opposite side. So again, the reaction conditions might change a little bit here. But this is again an alcohol that is formed. Then, fifth case, we are having 2 alcohols added again, so 2 hydroxy groups, but this time they are in antiposition. So one is added from the back and the other one is added from the front. That's opposed to the first reaction where we had like the syndiol, and in this case we can write antidiol. And next reaction product, okay, this looks like the ring is somehow opened. This looks rather suspicious. Okay, something has happened here. That's maybe very different from what we've seen before. But the 2 functional groups that we can identify is first a ketone and then a carboxylic acid. So let's write this down. Ketone and carb acid. Then the 7th reaction product, that's a 3-membered ring with an oxygen atom. That is an epoxide. Okay, also very interesting. And then the last reaction product is actually, again, a ketone component and an aldehyde. So looks kind of the same as we've seen in the 6th reactions, but not quite the same. So this is the analysis. So we are now looking for reaction conditions that can transform an alkene into a syndiol, an alcohol, an antibromo alcohol, and so on and so forth. Let's think about that for a moment. Syndiol, so we need to add the 2 oxygen atoms from the same side to the double bond. We've seen that in the lecture series, and actually how you can do that is by using osmium tetroxide. This molecule can add from the same side. What you could also use is potassium permanganate at low temperatures, because then the reaction doesn't proceed further and cleaves the double bond completely. So the answer here is osmium tetroxide or potassium permanganate at low reaction or at low temperatures. Second reactions, I've pointed that out when we analyzed the molecule. We are having an alcohol here, and the hydroxy group here is attached to the more substituted carbon, so it's the classical Markovnikov product. How can we transform an alcohol into a Markovnikov alcohol? That's with the normal acidic reaction conditions in water. So we can write here actually H plus proton in water, and this is then the solution for the second question. Then we are having something that looks like an anti-bromo alcohol. So first bromine from one side, and then something that introduces a hydroxide from the other group. So the reaction conditions here are actually bromine in water. And the intermediary stage that is important here is that the bromine first forms this three-membered intermediate that's positively charged, and the water molecule then adds from the other side. So but actually the water and the hydroxy group are not on the same side as the bromo molecule. Fourth reaction, we're having again an alcohol, and this time it's not the Markovnikov alcohol, but rather the anti-Markovnikov alcohol. And we've also seen how this can be done. This can be done by using first borane components, so for example BH3, and then write it like that, BH3, and then in the second step we are working up with hydrogen peroxide under basic conditions. So this is the reaction sequence here, so actually two steps how to proceed with that. First add the boron, and then work it up with hydrogen peroxide. Then we're having, for the fifth case here, we're having the anti-diol. And in this case, the hydroxy groups added from different sites. And how can we do this? Actually, this is produced by the first deformation of an epoxide, and then opening the epoxide from the other side with, for example, water under in water, maybe under acidic conditions. So what we can write here is we first need to produce somehow the epoxide. First reaction step is we need for that peroxo acid. We've discussed this the structure of this in the lecture, and then we work up in water with an acid present. So we are actually using an acidic workup here, and with that we are ending up with our target molecule here, so our anti-diol. From there, I would like to directly hop onto the epoxide, and this is actually like the intermediary stage here. So this is also produced by the use of a peroxy carboxylic acid that adds one of its positively polarized oxygen atoms onto the double bond in this case. And then we are left with these two ring opened products somehow. And this looks rather strange. To maybe analyze this a little bit further, we can also count the carbon atoms. Maybe we have lost one. So here we see, okay, it's a six-membered ring plus a mesyl group, so seven carbon atoms. And here we see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 7. And here also 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, so in both cases, we haven't lost a carbon atom. That's actually good to know. So there's nothing cleaved off somehow. And how you can solve this question is by how can you transform an alkene into a ketone somehow. And we've seen that with the different oxidizing agents. So for example, with ozone or potassium permanganate, you can split entire carbon-carbon double bonds. And this becomes a little bit more obvious if I draw the molecule in a different way. So let me first open this double bond up. So this is completely broken. We still have seven carbon atoms here. And if I now add the new carbonyl groups to these two fragments here, it becomes clear what is happening. So this is of course now way more over dramatic because like the one carbon component looks like very long here in this case. But overall, this is the two reaction products in the arrangement that you can maybe easily see what has happened here. So the double bond is cleaved in the reaction that we are looking for. And now the only question that remains in this case here, so we are splitting the carbon-carbon double bond, and we are using in the first reaction, we are looking for an agent that produces ketones and then a carboxylic acid. So something that we've discussed here that can do this is, for example, first ozone, and then in the second reaction step, we need to work up under oxidizing conditions to achieve this product here, because then the intermediary formed aldehyde is further oxidized to form the carboxylic acid. And the same reaction conditions can actually be applied in this case here, but we're not using oxidizing conditions in the second reaction step, but we rather use, for example, reductive workup conditions, for example, here with this dimethyl sulfide, and then we're keeping the structure of our aldehyde intact. Some other reactions that can also work in this way are, for example, here you can, for this reaction with the ketone and the carboxylic acid, you could also use potassium permanganate under high temperatures. And for this case here, you can also, for example, use the periodic acid, which also is not strong enough to further oxidize an aldehyde towards a carboxylic acid. So this is my solution for these questions. So you can have a look at all of this here. Some of them are actually, I think, quite easy, and others are a little bit more tricky. But overall, the scheme to the conclusion to solving this question is first analyze the functional groups, and then think about what reactions do you know to transform your present functional group, in this case an alkene, into the desired other functional group, and then you can find out what the conclusion or the answer to the reaction conditions questions is.